next on Unsolved Mysteries. Everyone says musician Mia Zapata was destined to be a star until she came face to face with a vicious killer. Legend has it that Billy the Kid was gunned down by Sheriff Pat Garrett. But new evidence suggests that Garrett killed the wrong man. Two children from different families are rushed to the hospital. The only thing they have in common is their nanny. Also, we journey into the shadowy world of dreams. Can they predict the future? Our team is standing by. Perhaps you can help solve one of our cases. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Join us. Seattle, Washington. A hotspot for rock and roll music since the 1990s. Nirvana, Pearl Jam, and Alice in Chains all came out of its local music scene. Many thought a punk group called the Gits would also shoot to the top, and lead singer Mia Zapata would take them there. But 27-year-old Mia would never get the chance.
I went through many shows where afterwards people didn't even know I was up on stage because their eyes were so transfixed on Mia.
She was someone who had something to say. She was a very compassionate and big-hearted person, and she brought that into the band.
But early one summer morning, Mia's incredible voice was silenced. She left her friend's apartment around 2 in the morning. An hour later, her body was found a couple of miles away. She was lying face up in an almost Christ-like pose. Mia Zapata had been raped, beaten, and then strangled to death. No one can understand why this popular young singer had been attacked and murdered. Was her killer an obsessed fan, a jealous enemy, or perhaps just a complete stranger? You might say that Mia was born to be a star. She grew up in Kentucky, the daughter of 2 television executives. It was at Antioch College where she met the other 3 members of her band. After 5 years of performing together, the Gits were attracting the attention of major record companies and planning their first U.S. tour.
I don't think I can ever remember my daughter looking so satisfied, so content, so at ease with herself.
The night Mia was murdered began at one of her favorite bars, where she met friends around 10 p.m. She only stayed there for a while, then left the bar and walked to a local rehearsal studio 1 block away.
You want to crash on the couch tonight?
Thanks.
Mia then visited a friend who lived in the same building as the studio. At around 2 a.m., she left her friend's apartment saying she planned to take a cab home.
I'm going to just go get a cab.
She could have gone anywhere from there. She could have gone out the front entrance, gone down to the corner, and hailed a cab as she told her friend she was going to do.
Hey, Mia!
Oh, hi.
Hey, where are you going?
Mia knew many of the local cab drivers because she didn't have a driver's license.
You don't need any money. Come on.
It was first thought that Mia had been murdered by a cab driver.
You're looking good.
Mia did not have difficulty expressing her opinion. And sometimes this got her into trouble, and other people liked it. She could have said something to a cab driver that she knew that just made that person angry that night.
None of the drivers said they had picked up Mia that night, and none of her friends, who would also have been taking cabs, reported seeing her. Then there's theory number two.
She also could have gone into the opposite direction. She lived about five blocks away. She could have gone down 11th, past a reservoir, and something could have occurred there.
In fact, something did occur, but no one knows if it had anything to do with Mia's death.
One of the earliest clues that the police received was from a man who had heard a scream, a terrifying scream that night. He was so distraught by it that he actually rushed to see what was going on, but he saw nothing. He lived, however, very close to the reservoir on 11th, where Mia could have gone.
And finally, theory number three. Perhaps Mia never left the building where she was last seen. The day after her murder, one of Mia's friends stopped by the rehearsal studio, and she found Mia's personal microphone, which she rarely let out of her sight.
We don't know whether she left it there after the practice that night, or whether she went back to the studio after visiting her friend. Something happened there, and this was simply left.
Mia's body was found about 2 miles from the studio and about 3 miles from the street where the man heard the screams. Police thoroughly searched the area, but found nothing.
This particular investigation has been difficult because we're faced with a situation where we don't know where the actual crime scene was, where the murder took place. We obviously only know where we found Mia at, which we don't believe is the same.
Had a dream last night that I was dead.
Without a crime scene or witnesses, the investigation grew cold. However, the pain of Mia's death did not.
People really were mad. They were shocked. And people wanted justice, and people wanted to know what had happened.
The remaining gets decided to take action. They hired private investigator Lee Heron and staged benefit concerts to raise money for the investigation. The response was overwhelming. Seattle's leading musicians got involved, including Nirvana and rocker Joan Jett.
I want more than anything for them to be able to find out what happened, and so there can be some resolution for everybody, because everyone's been working real hard trying to find this person who did this.
The passion of life I have left, I'm gonna use it to sacrifice myself. Well,
I just remembered the look on her face of contentment and of accomplishment that last day when we finished the tour, and how happy she was and how she was smiling with a look of real sense of accomplishment, like we had a future.
Playing music without Mia is very difficult. The chemistry that we shared as a band, having that gone forever, is a hard reality to face every day. I remember her as one of the warmest, most caring, ultra-talented people I've ever met in my life.
Update. 10 years after Mia Zapata was killed, Seattle police tested DNA from the case against the national database. They found a match. Jesus Mesquia, a felon living in Miami, Florida, was arrested and charged with murder. Mesquia didn't know Mia Zapata, but at the time of her killing, he lived just 3 blocks from where her body was found. Jesus Mesquia was convicted of first-degree murder and sentenced to 36 years in prison. Next, Brushy Bill Roberts of Hyco, Texas, claimed that Billy the Kid was not killed by Sheriff Pat Garrett. Brushy says that he was Billy the Kid. Billy the Kid, easily the most notorious desperado of the Wild West. He killed 21 men. One for every year of his young life. History tells us that Billy the Kid was born William Bonney in New York City in 1859. Later, in New Mexico, he fought against rich ranchers in the Lincoln County Cattle War, and that he was sentenced to death for killing Sheriff William Brady. According to most sources, Lincoln County Sheriff Pat Garrett was eager to collect the $500 bounty on Billy the Kid. In July of 1881, he tracked Billy down in Fort Sumner, New Mexico, and killed him. History also tells us that Billy was buried the following day in a simple grave. But now, some people say that history is wrong. That Billy wasn't the man in the grave.
This whole legend of Billy the Kid, 90% of what we have heard and been taught as students in schools, is not true.
68 years after Billy's death, a man from Texas named Brushy Bill Roberts claimed that he was Billy the Kid.
There is no doubt whatever in my mind but what Brushy Bill and Billy the Kid was one and the same person.
Historian Donald Lavash disagrees.
There is absolutely no comparison whatsoever between Brushy Bill Roberts, known as Ole Partridge Roberts, and William Bonney, alias Billy the Kid.
Most historians completely dismiss Brushy Bill's story, but there is evidence to support his claim. Evidence that's hard to ignore. It all started in 1948 when an attorney named William Morrison was told that Billy the Kid might not have died in 1881. A client told him that he had actually fought Billy the Kid in the Lincoln County Wars and that the Kid was still alive.
And as my father was talking to the man, he referred to Lincoln County. My father said, oh, he said, that's where Billy the Kid, he said, he was killed up there at Pete Maxwell's house. And the man said, oh, no, no, he wasn't killed. He's still around.
Morrison was so intrigued that he decided to do some of his own investigating. He traveled throughout the West, talking to other old-timers about Billy the Kid. And he discovered that many thought that Billy was still alive. They said that he was going by the name of Brushy Bill Roberts. William Morrison decided to visit Texas and to talk to Brushy Bill in person.
Howdy, William Morrison. Brushy Bill here.
I am Billy the Kid. Come on in, we'll talk about this a little further.
We must keep in mind that this man did not seek publicity. He did not seek to come out from seclusion. He was drawn out.
Come on in.
Brushy Bill asked Morrison to help him get the official pardon that New Mexico's governor had promised him back in 1879.
I expect a full pardon out of this.
But you have to be able to prove to me you are who you say you are.
I can do that. I've still got the scars.
His scars match the wounds that Billy had supposedly received during his time as an outlaw.
It's from a knife wound down south of the border.
There were 17 points of identification of similarity between the two. Both men had small hands and large wrists, protruding teeth, protruding ears, blue eyes, same head size, same boot size, and the weight.
There's no record anywhere where there's anything having to do with a boot size of Billy the Kid, a waist size of Billy the Kid, or a hat size of Billy the Kid, nothing. But it does tell us something about his eyes, unequivocally, without question, that they were clear blue eyes. Brushy Bill had speckled eyes.
Right over that hill there,
We used to camp out.
Brushy Bill took William Morrison on a guided tour of some of Billy's former haunts in Lincoln County.
Back in there.
Brushy Bill would give incidents that only someone that was actually involved in the Lincoln County War would have known.
William Morrison talked to five people who knew Billy during the Lincoln County War. Each of them signed sworn statements declaring that Brushy Bill Roberts was indeed Billy the Kid.
My father became convinced that this man was Billy the Kid.
If this is true, then one puzzling question remains. What really happened on the night the kid was supposedly killed?
Who was that? Hey.
Brushy Bill said that he was with his girlfriend and his partner, Billy Barlow, at Jesus Silva's home. The following are the exact words Brushy used when he told the story to William Morrison.
Silva said if one of us would go next door and get beef, he would cook it for us. I sensed a trap.
You go. Me?
Yeah. He started out after I refused to leave the house. I thought that Garrett might still be in town, and I wanted to meet him in the daytime so I could beat him to it.
Sheriff Garrett and his posse were waiting outside.
One of their first shots had killed my partner. I ran out into the yard. I ran through the gate and started shooting at shadows along the house. The first shot struck me in the lower jaw. Another struck me in the shoulder, and then another struck me across the top of my head. When I woke up, a Mexican woman was putting beef tallow on my head to stop the blood. I told her to reload my .44. Then Selsa came running in and said they'd killed Barlow and were passing off his body as mine. She begged me to leave town.
Brushy claimed the next day that Billy Barlow was buried in his place.
In a normal procedure, the sheriff would have brought the corpse to a place for anyone to witness. He would have demonstrated his guns, his clothing, his boots, his rifle. Pat Garrett did not follow that procedure. He took every precaution to conceal the identity of the corpse. He realized he had killed the wrong man.
Pat Garrett enlisted some 21 people that purportedly knew William Bonney. And they assembled, passed by the casket, and said, yes, that's William Bonney, Billy the Kid, in that casket.
William Morrison finally believed he had gathered enough evidence to ask the New Mexico governor for a pardon.
How do we know you're not a prosecutor?
They were all saying, if he is Billy the Kid, he's an outlaw, he's a criminal. You don't pardon him, you hang him.
The interview turned into a press circus. 90-year-old Brushy was confused and attacked by reporters, historians, and even Pat Garrett's relatives.
Brushy, who's buried in that grave if Pat Garrett didn't kill Billy the Kid?
How many aliases have you had all these years?
Governor Mabry, do you really intend to give this man a pardon?
I am taking no action now or ever on this application for a pardon for Billy the Kid because I do not believe this man to be Billy the Kid.
The governor never even gave him a chance to present the evidence by just flat-out telling him he wasn't even going to consider it.
A short time later, Brushy Bill Roberts had a heart attack and died on a street in Hyco, Texas.
All he wanted was to have his name cleared. That's all he was trying to do, giving back his dignity.
Brushy's friends have erected a memorial to Brushy Bill Roberts, which reads, quote, he spent the last days of his life trying to prove to the world his true identity. We believe his story and pray to God for the forgiveness he solemnly asked for. Next, the mysterious injuries of two children are traced to an abusive nanny who is now on the run. Los Angeles, California. Paramedics rush 4-year-old Ashley Berman to the emergency room. She is unconscious and barely breathing.
Can you tell me how this happened?
She apparently had some sort of seizure and fell and hit her head.
How far was the fall?
It wasn't far. She just fell on the floor. I don't know. I wasn't there. I was just with the nanny.
A short time later, the doctors make a shocking accusation.
Give me a CAT scan.
Ashley had been physically assaulted by her nanny.
I looked at him and said, no way. I said, I don't know what you're talking about. You know, Rosa would never hurt Ashley. She took care of her. We had neighbors that would see Rosa and Ashley at the park. They would call me up and tell me how lucky I was to have somebody like Rosa. I did not believe him.
The Bermans met Rosa Hernandez when she applied to be the live-in nanny for 2-year-old Ashley.
Worked for them for 1 year.
That first day, Hernandez brought her cousin to help translate.
Oh, me encantan los niños.
Rosa was very highly recommended by various neighbors. One neighbor said that she was wonderful and that she would be perfect to watch our daughter and that she had experience with kids and she was very good at what she did.
Es muy importante. Hi, Rosa. This is Ashley. I give it yes.
When we brought Ashley down to meet her, Ashley seemed to connect very well as Rosa connected with Ashley. So I felt that this was definitely going to work out and that she'd be good with Ashley.
The next week, Rosa Hernandez moved in with the Bermans. From the beginning, she and Ashley were inseparable.
Ashley seemed to be very fond of Rosa. She always wanted to buy things for Rosa. She'd always talk about Rosa. She always wanted to make Rosa feel happy.
For a year, everything went well. Then, Ashley began suffering from a series of mysterious injuries.
What happened to your arm?
A boy hit me.
At school?
Every time we asked Ashley, what happened, how did you get this, she'd always tell us it happened at school, that she hurt her hand on the swing, that a little boy hit her with a shovel, another child hit her with a Barbie.
But then it happened at home. Ashley got a deep gash on her head that required several stitches.
You fell down the stairs. Were you there, Mom?
No, the nanny was with her.
What happened?
She jumped.
Hernandez said Ashley was blacking out and having seizures. Although the Bermans never witnessed an episode themselves, they feared that Ashley had developed a serious physiological disorder.
We put Ashley through all kinds of tests. We put her through CAT scans, MRIs, which were very difficult to get a 4.5-year-old child into an MRI. With all the tests, they could find absolutely nothing related towards seizures. All indications was is that she was a very healthy child.
A few months later, Jeff came home early from a walk. He found that Ashley had been injured once again.
Rosa proceeded to tell me that Ashley had fallen down. She was wearing some shoes and she tripped and she fell down. And I felt comfortable that she had just fallen. When the scene was reenacted by Ashley, it all made sense.
Just 9 days later, Ashley was rushed to the emergency room.
Can you tell me what happened?
I thought Ashley was gonna die on us. I mean, I just looked at her, she was all pale, hooked up, and I thought we were gonna lose her. And pretty much we were told if she survived, if she lived, she'd more than likely be retarded or blind or both.
Give me a CAT scan, full set of labs.
After I examined Ashley, I was suspicious that Ashley might have been abused. She had some small hemorrhages in the retina. This is a condition that's associated with shaken baby syndrome.
Dr. Gillingham decided to check Ashley's medical history. He called her pediatrician.
I have one of your patients here, Ashley Berman. showing signs of retinal.
It wasn't until I spoke with Ashley's pediatrician that we made a connection to a prior case where the same caregiver had been involved in taking care of a child who died of what they thought might be child abuse.
This way, number two.
2 years earlier, Dr. Gillingham had treated a 17-month-old boy who was rushed to the hospital in a state of full cardiac arrest. That day, the toddler had been in the care of Rosa Hernandez. The Bermans knew about the incident, but had heard the boy choked on a hot dog.
We were able to resuscitate the child. The child was subsequently admitted to the hospital, but then died within the next, 17 or 18 hours.
An autopsy revealed that the boy had a fractured skull and internal bleeding. His death was ruled a homicide. However, there wasn't enough evidence to charge Rosa Hernandez. But now, with Ashley fighting for her life, police believe they have a case against Hernandez.
Why are you doing this to me?
She was charged with child abuse and murder.
I love her.
Ashley remained in the hospital for a week. Eventually, she made a full recovery. And with the experience behind her, Ashley was willing to talk about Rosa Hernandez.
She used to push me down the steps. I would hide her remote control to get her back. And so she took silverware and hit my nails. And she would also take her earrings and poke them through my nails. And she would bang my head against the walls, the doors, and the wood floors.
Hernandez pleaded guilty to involuntary manslaughter and child abuse. Despite protests from the Bermans, she was released on her own recognizance. Rosa Hernandez immediately disappeared.
I believe that it's been a long enough period of time that she feels safe, and I fear, and she may be babysitting right now, another child that's going to fall victim to her abuse.
Maria Rosa Hernandez is from El Salvador. She's 5'4" and weighs approximately 130 pounds. She is a mother of three. Hernandez speaks broken English and has what appears to be burn scars on her right upper forearm. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, the world of psychic dreams. Do some people really see into the future while they sleep? Have you ever had a dream that was so vivid you thought it was real? It may seem unbelievable, but you're about to meet several people who are convinced that their dreams really do come true. New York City. Glenn Loney is a professor at Brooklyn College. His story begins on a cold winter night when he says he had a dream that saved his life.
I was driving up a hill, and there was a blind curve up at the top. There came a car around the curve. There's a little two-wheel trailer behind it, and suddenly the outside wheel of the trailer comes off, and there was a shower of sparks like a sparkler. The wheel came skidding across the road toward my car, and I thought, step on the gas or you're a dead man. And I woke up in a cold sweat. I never had a dream that I remembered every particular detail of, and it was so vivid as if it had actually happened.
A few months later, Glenn was on a business trip with another professor. They were driving through a part of the country where they had never been before.
How's your classes going, by the way?
Oh, doing fine.
Good.
Halfway up, I realized this is the hill of my dream. This is the place. There was no traffic coming the other way, nothing.
You all right, Glenn?
No, I'm not.
I said, my God, a car's going to come around that curve, and a wheel's going to come off the trailer, and it's going to come at our car. I've got to step on the gas or we're dead.
Some would say that what happened to Glenn was just a coincidence. However, there are many people who believe that what he experienced was a psychic dream, a dream that predicts the future.
There's a clear distinction between ordinary dreaming, which we all do every night, and a psychic dream. And the clear distinction is that a psychic dream wakes you bolt upright out of bed. It's a clear, vivid dream that literally shocks you awake. And after you wake, you have this urgency to do something about it, this urgency to expect something.
So what I'll do is I'll go through all of these.
Dr. David Ryback is a leading authority on psychic dreams. He and freelance author Letitia Schweitzer have written a book which contains more than 80 case studies. Dr. Ryback concluded that as many as 1 out of every 12 people have experienced a psychic dream.
When I first realized that I had the ability to see into the future through my dreams was when I was a teenager.
Rhonda, who is featured in Dr. Ryback's book, was living in Knoxville, Tennessee when she began dating Joe Anderson. Joe went camping for the weekend, and that night Rhonda had a dream that an uninvited guest came to his campsite.
My heart was pounding so hard that I had to sit up in my bed, and I looked at the clock, and it was 3:00 in the morning.
Hello.
Hi, honey. How you doing?
Oh, Joe, I'm so glad you called. Is everything
I told her we'd had an incident with a bear and decided to leave, come back home early.
He told her that a sound outside his tent woke him up.
Go. Shoot. She'd had the dream about 3:00.
Get out of here. Shoot. Shoot, go away.
It must have been about the time that the bear had come into camp and torn things up.
Come on, get out of here, shoot.
About a year later, Joe and Rhonda got married. Not surprisingly, his new stepdaughter, Roxanne, also claimed to have psychic dreams.
Some families have 2 or 3 people in the family who not only have psychic dreams, but have the same psychic dreams, which is a really astounding event.
Rhonda and Roxanne have had that experience. One night, Rhonda dreamed that Joe was in a terrible accident. A week later, Roxanne said that she had the very same dream.
Our car was on the side of the road, and then I saw a glimpse of Joe, his head, his face, and then I saw police writing a police report. It was really, really disturbing to me. It really upset me because it just, you know, it scared me and it felt like it was something that was gonna happen.
I said, let's just think positively about it and let's just pray that everything will be okay. And from then on, I would just ask Joe to please be careful.
Joe was driving to the mountains for another camping trip when he took his eyes off the road for just a second.
Luckily, I wasn't injured. Of course, the first thing I thought about after that happened was that Rhonda had warned me to be very careful, and I had not paid attention to the road and slid off and had the accident.
Had we not warned him over and over again to please be careful, we don't know what would have happened.
The Andersons were lucky. Their story had a happy ending. But that wasn't the case for Catherine Webb.
Joe, I'm so glad you're back. It's so good to see you.
20-year-old Catherine Webb fell in love with a soldier named Joe Stewart, but they decided not to get married because of family obligations.
Yes, I've always regretted that. Instead of being so conscientious about our obligations, we should have thought of ourselves.
And though she would marry someone else, Catherine never forgot her first love. Years later, she began having a disturbing, recurring dream.
Dr. Rabot to ICU. Dr. Rabot.
All I saw was these nurses and doctors, a lot of confusion. The doctor seemed very concerned.
Now, this man's been here.
Probably working on someone. That was would be how it would look. And then it seemed to me that I just got the intuition that it's about Joe Stewart.
A short time later, Catherine had another dream.
I turned around and Joe was standing there.
Joe?
Kate, I came to tell you that I died.
Joe, I don't understand this.
I'll explain.
I could smell flowers and fern.
Thanks to your prayers, I'll have a Christian burial.
And I looked down at the man in the casket.
And I came to tell you that I'll always love you.
A few days later, Catherine visited Joe's sister and brother-in-law. She was shocked to find out that Joe had gone into a coma the same day that she had the first dream. He had died of a brain aneurysm just 2 days before he appeared to Catherine in her dream about the church.
Joe came to me in a dream.
And when I did tell them, his sister said yes. She said, every detail you've told us, she said, is just the way it was.
Perhaps the phenomenon of psychic dreams will always be beyond our understanding. There is no way to explain them. They are, truly, an unsolved mystery. Next, it's the real-life CSI. Coroners try to solve some of law enforcement's toughest cases. When a coroner is called to the scene of a death, it's their job to remove the body and determine how the victim died. Often, not an easy task. Seal Beach, California. Early one fall morning, two lifeguards find the body of a young boy floating in a channel near the ocean. The body is so badly decomposed, they can't identify him. Coroner's investigator Joe Lucky was sent to the scene.
It takes a while sometimes to get over the fact that you can't identify these people. You think about your own families and know that there's somebody out there who's missing a relative. Somebody, but we don't know who.
He found no evidence of foul play. An autopsy later revealed that the young boy had drowned. But who the boy was and where he came from was still a baffling mystery. Joe sent a description of the boy to every law enforcement agency in the area. Only one possible match turned up. A boy who had disappeared from Fullerton, California. But Fullerton was 16 miles from where the body was discovered.
Fullerton.
Joe met the boy's parents, who said their son had disappeared shortly after taking a walk to a local park.
I went over to the park and I found that there was a flood control channel right adjacent to the park. I also discovered that because of the rainfall the day of his missing, that the flood control district had opened a local dam and allowed the overflow to come through that channel, raising it approximately 6 feet higher than normal.
The boy was only 9 years old. He had fallen into the flood channel and been swept 16 miles to Seal Beach. Blood samples later provided a positive identification. But some cases remain unsolved, even after years of investigation.
A coroner is probably a good mixture of being a surgeon, a detective, and an attorney. Every day is a challenge. It's new all the time.
One case in particular continues to haunt Cullen Ellenberg. The body of a woman in her early 20s was found at the bottom of a steep cliff in Southern California.
What do you got?
The woman had apparently fallen to her death sometime during the night.
We weren't sure at that point if it was an accident or intentional or if she had been pushed. I went to the top of the cliff, and there I found a small purse, a half-consumed soda, and a map of Southern California.
Strangely, there was nothing else in her purse, but the map led Cullen to the last person who saw her alive.
There was a phone number on the map. The phone number was that of a cab company, and the cab company was contacted, and they indicated they had a fare picked up from the area and dropped off at the area of the Dana Point Cliffs at about 3 or 4 that morning.
The cab driver described the Jane Doe who fell to her death at Dana Point.
You the lady called for a cab?
Yeah. Can you take me?
She wanted to go to Laguna Beach, but didn't have enough cash.
I only have 18.
The cab driver agreed to take her as far as the money would go.
Yeah, sure, get the bag.
The only thing the taxi driver said was that she had very little to say other than that. She was very quiet, and he didn't notice anything really unusual about her.
The meter says $18, ma'am. That's the best I can do.
Thank you.
Good night.
Goodbye.
The next morning, the young woman's body was found at the base of the cliff. She was 5'8" tall and weighed 127 pounds. She had light brown hair, brown eyes, and was wearing what appeared to be secondhand clothing, including a pair of men's underwear. Update. There are new developments in this case. Here's one of our staff with details.
After remaining a mystery for 26 years, this case has finally been solved. The remains have been positively identified, thanks to DNA testing, as those of Holly Jo Glynn. Holly was 21 years old when she died. Her death was ruled a suicide.